We are going to discuss about the returns to scale, the topic which is in industrial economics of BA final year economics subject. Okay, returns to scale, it explains how a company will get production in long run. That means the long run production is explained by returns to scale. What is returns and what is the scale? We should learn about this point before going to the class. Okay, what is scale? Yes. Scale, generally the production will be done by the production factors. You know the production factors: land, labor, capital, entrepreneurship. These are the production factors. If you want to get production, you should use these production factors. Okay, the combination of the different production factors is called as scale. What is scale? The combination of different production factors is called as scale. Each product has its own different type of the scale. For example, we are producing a good, maybe it is X. What is the scale for that good? For example, we want, one is labor, second one is capital. Okay, so zoom it. We want one unit, we want labor production factor, and second one is capital production factor. Okay, for example, I am taking 1 unit of labor and 2 units of capital. This will give some level of production. Okay, so how much we are using labor and capital? 1 unit of labor and 2 units of capital. We can say that the proportion of the labor and capital is 1:2. Okay, what is 1:2? 1:2 is a proportion of the labor and capital to product, the unit of that good. Okay, this 1:2 is called as scale. Okay, then if you want to increase the production, so you should increase the scale. Okay, for example, next level of the production, we want 2 units of labor and 4 units of the capital. Okay, so we are increasing the labor and we are increasing the capital. By increasing the labor and capital, we can get more production. Okay, then you observe, what is the scale for labor and capital? Okay, we are using 2 units of labor and 4 units of capital. So what is the ratio between labor and capital? This is also 1:2. 1:2. Okay, here we are increasing labor units and capital units, but the scale or the proportion between labor and capital is constant. So make constant production scale. We are using that constant production scale. So we are not altering the scale, but we are increasing labor and capital, okay, without changing or without altering its scale. So we are increasing the labor and capital, automatically we will get more production. Okay, and this is called as scale. So we are not altering or we are not changing the scale, but we are increasing the labor and capital. By this we are getting more production. Okay, so I think you understand what is scale. Okay, for example, we can, if you take another product, okay, now we are going another produce another product. For example, it is a Y product. So for that, the labor is required 1 unit and the capital is required 3 units. Then what is the scale for this product? 1:3. 1:3. Okay, so this is different from the previous product. So the scale of this product is 1:3. If you increase the labor and the capital, for example, we are increasing labor to 2 units, this is 6 units, even though the scale is not changed, that is 1:3. So we are, without altering the scale, we are increasing the labor and capital. By increasing the labor and capital, how we will get the increase in the production, that will be described or that will be discussed by the returns to scale. Okay, so we are now going to explain the returns to scale. Now here you observe this diagram. On OX axis we are taking labor, on OY axis we are taking capital. Okay, so now we are using labor and capital as production factors. Okay, then you observe these three lines from O to P, this is a scale. Okay, O to Q, this is another one scale. O to R, this is another scale. So OP, OQ, OR are different combination of the labor and capital. These are showing that these are different combination of the labor and capital. If you take OQ, OQ is a labor intensive technique. If you take OR, OR is a capital intensive technique. OP is using labor and capital in same ratio. Okay, so if we are going on a line, this is a path, this is the path. Okay, if you are increasing the labor and capital on this path, how there are changes in production, that will be explained by returns to scale. One more thing I am explaining, that if we are increasing labor and capital on OP path, how the changes occur in production, that will be explained by the returns to scale. Okay, now according to the theory, there are three types of returns to scale in production. In the first stage, if we are increasing the production by increasing the labor and capital or any other production factors, in first stage we will get increasing returns to scale. That means, for example, if the production factors increased at 10%, we will get more than 10% increase in the production. Okay, are you understanding my point? That if you increase the 10% in production factors, we will get more than 10% of the production. Okay, we will get more than 10% increase in the production. A greater possibility for the specialization. First one is greater possibility for the specialization, and second one is there are some indivisibilities in production factors that also very useful in first stage, that will lead to the increasing returns to scale. And the third one, dimensional economies also will give increasing returns to the scale in the first stage. Okay, by these three. What are the three? Dimensional economies, indivisibilities in production factors, and possibility for the specialization. These three will give increasing returns in the first stage. If you go on that path, we will enter into the second stage. What is the second stage? In second stage, we will get constant returns to scale. What do you mean by the constant returns to scale? If you increase the production factors at 10%, at same level of the output you will get. That means you also get 10% increase in the production. Okay, one more thing I am saying, that if you increase the production factors at 10%, automatically the production also increases at 10%. So this is called as constant returns to scale. Okay, after that we will enter into the third stage. What is the third stage? Decreasing returns to scale. That means if you increase the production factors at 10%, the production will increase below that 10%. Okay? How much you are increasing the production, that will not help to the increase in the production. There are number of reasons for that decreasing returns to scale. Okay? So you understand that there are three stages of the returns to scale. In first stage, we will get increasing returns to scale. In second stage, we will get constant returns to scale. At third stage, we will get diminishing or decreasing returns to scale. Okay, right, start. Okay, in first stage, how we will get the production increase, we are going to discuss through this diagram. Okay, in this diagram, we are taking labor on x-axis and capital on y-axis. So we are using these two production factors and we are going on OP path. Okay, how the production will increase, this diagram is showing that. Okay, up to OA. Okay, and this is what is this? This is isocant curve. That means this is a production line. It is indicating that 100 units of the production. Okay, if we are using OA level of inputs, we are getting 100 units of the production. Okay, then OA, if we are increasing or we are forwarding on this path, then we are getting the second isocant line, that is indicating 100 units of the production. Okay, so just you observe here, we are getting 100 units of the production by OA level. Okay, we are getting another extra 100 units by this AB level. Okay, here you observe OA is greater than AB. OA is greater than AB. Okay, and if you go on the path, we will get 300 units of the production by just using BC amount of the production factors. If you think BC is less than AB or AB is greater than BC, just you observe here, AB is greater than BC. That means we are getting the same level of production, but we are using less units of the capital and labor. Okay, by using less amount of the production factors, we are getting more production. That is why we are calling this as increasing returns to stage or increasing returns to scale. In the first stage of the production path, we are getting increasing returns. Stop. Okay. This diagram is showing the constant returns to scale. Okay, if we are increasing labor and capital and we are moving on OP path, we are getting 100 units of the production unit, 100 units of the production with OA level of production factors. If you increase OA to AB, you will get 200 units of the production. Okay, so these three isocants are expressing 100, 200, 300 units of the production. Okay, here we are OA level of production factors using, here AB level, here BC level of the production factors. Just you can observe that here OA is equal to AB is equal to BC. You observe here OA is equal to AB and AB is equal to BC. That means we are getting same level of output by using same level of increase in the production factors. So that is why we are saying that this is second stage of the scale. Okay, that means we are getting constant returns to scale in production. This diagram shows about decreasing returns to scale. Okay, here on OP path, you observe the movement O to A, A to B, B to C. We are getting 100, 200, 300 units of the production. Okay, here OA production factors level is giving 100 units. If you want to get extra 100 units, you should move from A to B. Here OA is less than AB. OA is less than AB. That means we are using more production factors to get the same level of output. Okay, and you observe on this path, AB is less than BC. That means if you get extra 100 units of the production, you should use more production factors to get that production level. So that means here we can observe that we are getting decreasing returns to scale. Here Y is less than AB and AB is less than BC. Okay, I think you can easily understand in this diagram that these isochrons are moving towards up, towards right. Okay, the distance between these two isochrons is less than distance between these two isochrons. Okay, here this distance is less, here the distance is more. If you go on this part, the distance also will increase.
Okay.
Today you observed in returns to scale the three stages of the returns to scale: increasing returns to scale, decreasing returns to scale, and constant returns to scale. Why you are getting these different stages in returns to scale? The reason is economies. Okay, there are two types of economies are there. One is internal economies and second one is external economies. What is the internal economies? The internal economies, if a single firm is going to expand its production, that firm will get some economies. Those economies are called as internal economies. That means these economies only are applicable to the firm which is going to increase its production. Okay, and what is external economies? If the firms of the industry, that means there are number of firms are there in the industry, if the industry, sometimes industry also gets some economies, those economies are called as external economies. That means the every firm of the industry will get these economies. That is why we are calling this as external economies. Okay, once again you observe the difference between internal economies and external economies, that the internal economies only applicable to the firm who is going to expand its production. Okay, and what are external economies? The firms of the industry. When we are increasing the production, how there are different stages in production, why we are getting sometimes increasing returns, why we are getting sometimes decreasing returns? Okay, why we are getting increasing returns or why we are getting decreasing returns in scale? There are a reason for that is economies. Economy. The economies are divided into two categories. One is internal economies, another one is external economies. What is internal economies? If a firm is going to expand its production capacity or production, that firm will get some economies. Those are called as internal economies. If the industry, sometimes industry also will get some type of economies, those economies are called external economies. Okay, external economies are applicable to all firms of that industry. That means that every firm of the industry will get those economies. That is why we are calling that as external economies. So just you observe what is the difference between internal and external economies. Once again I am telling that the internal economies will be applicable to the firm which is going to expand its production capacity. Okay, the external economies are applicable to the all forms of the industry. Okay, so external economies are applicable to all firms. Internal economies only for one firm which is going to expand its production. Okay, here these are the internal economies. There are six type of internal economies are. One is technical economies, two managerial economies, third one is financial economies, fourth one marketing economies, fifth one R&D, that means research and development economies, sixth one risk bearing economy. Oh, okay, here we are going to discuss about these six internal economies. What is technical economies? Sometimes a firm who is going to expand its production capacity, that firm may get some type of economies. Those are called technical economies. Generally, these are related to the technological issues, then maybe for the improving its machinery or increasing its building capacity. Okay, here I will explain that with an example. Okay, here I am going to build a room with four walls. Okay, here one room is with four walls. If you expand the building capacity, if we want another room, how will build that? By using only three walls. Okay, first room is constructed by four walls, but the second room is constructed by only three walls. So here that company, that firm is saving one some level of expenditure. So this is called as technical type of economics. Okay, and then what is second one? Managerial economics. If a firm is going to expand its production, that company may recruit some managers. Those managers will be able to manage the cost of that firm and our expenditure of that firm, and how to improve the revenue and how to reduce the cost. Those are taken by the manager decision. Okay, by doing these decision, some type of economies will be got by that firm. Okay, these type of called economies are called as managerial economies. Okay, what is third one? Financial economies. Okay, what is financial economies? Okay, if a company is going to expand its capacity, that company may get financial resources, finance, by own at that only low level of interest. If you go to if you take a loan from a bank for 1 lakh, that bank may charge 1% of the interest rate per month. Okay, if you take 1 crore from that bank may charge below 1% for the interest rate. Okay, that means here you can observe that if you are going to take more loans or more finance from financial market, you will get those finance at low level of interest. That is also one type of economies. This economy is called as financial economies. Okay, what is the next one? Marketing economies. If you are going to market your product, then the some type of marketing economies you will get it in advertising mode or in other activities, you may get some economies. These are marketing economies. Okay, the fifth one is R&D, in research and development. Okay, if your firm is going to expand its capacity, some level of research and development it will be done by that firm. Okay, that research will be helpful for the firm. Okay, maybe that research will reduce the cost of the production, or it may increase the productivity of that firm. Okay, these will be helpful for the firm. Okay, the last one is risk bearing economies. Okay, if small firm is producing one good, If that good is not sold in the market, that firm will get losses. If the large firm is producing more than one good, for example, three goods, in those three goods, two goods are sold at high profits, and the third one is sold at low profits or at losses. And that losses is covered by the other profits which are coming from other product selling. Okay, so automatically the large firm may able to take the risk. Okay, this is called as risk bearing economies. So these are the internal economies. These internal economies only for the firm who is going to expand its production stuff. Here we are going to discuss about external economies. There are four types of external economies. In those, one is infrastructural economies, two is specialization economies, third one is information and marketing economies, fourth one research economies. Okay, in those, first one is infrastructural economies. Okay, if the industry here, what you know that in this external economies, the external economies are applicable to the all firms who are in that industry. Okay, so all firms will get these economies. Oh, okay, in that one, infrastructural economies. If that industry, for example, it is a car industry or motor vehicle industry, or it is a textile industry. Okay, what do you mean by textile industry? That means the firms who are producing textile all are called as textile industry. Okay, so if you take a textile industry, then there are infrastructural facilities, infrastructural economies are applicable to those firms who are in that industry. Okay, if the industry is going to expand its capacity, automatically infrastructural facilities are very useful to those firms who are in that industry. Okay, what are infrastructure facilities? Roads, railways, that means transport, communication, electricity, okay, building, whatever it may be, financial banks, financial institutions. These will give more choice to that industry. Okay, by using these resources, the firms of that industry will grow up. Okay, this type of economies are called as infrastructural economies. Okay, what is second one? Specialization economies. If an industry is expand its production capacity, the specialization may occur in that industry. If you take textile industry, okay, what are the stages in textile industry? Ginning of the cotton, and second one is threading, third one is weaving. Okay, if you take these three stages, the specialization occur in each stage. Some firms of that industry will go to ginning side. Some firms of that industry will make only threading. Some firms of that industry will do only weaving of the cloths. Okay, so this specialization will be occurred when the industry expand its capacity. Okay, if a specialization occurs, some type of economies will be done in that industry. Okay, these economies are called as specialization economy. Okay, third one is information and marketing. If the industry is going expanding its capacity, some type of information be gathered by that industry. Okay, it is not possible when that industry is at small level. If the industry is expanding its level to a big stage, the information bureaus, will be shared by the firms of that industry. It is very easy to understand. It is very easy to know what is going in the market. The firms will get aware about the information, or those will aware of the marketing problems which are in the present market. Okay, these are called information and marketing economies. The fourth one is research economy. If the industry is big, some type of research will go on in that industry. Some all the firms of the industry may able to expand its some money for the research. Okay, and that research will be helpful for the industry. If the research is successful, that industry also will get those benefits by successful research. Okay, these are called external research, external economies. These economies are applicable to the all firms who are in the industry. Thank you.